about how the bride saw the most sweet Virgin Mary adorned with a crown and other adornments of indescribable beauty, and about how Saint John the Baptist explains to the bride the meaning of the crown and the other adornments. Chapter 31. The Bride of God saw the Queen of Heaven, the Mother of God, wearing a priceless and beautiful crown on her head and her wonderfully shining and indescribably beautiful hair hanging down over her shoulders, with a golden tunic shining with an indescribable light, and a blue mantle of the color azure or a clear sky. When the Bride of God, Saint Bridget, was full of wonder at such a lovely sight, and in her wonderment, was standing there totally enraptured and amazed, then blessed John the Baptist appeared to her and said, "Listen closely to what all this signifies. The crown signifies that she is the Queen and Lady and Mother of the King of Angels. The hair hanging down signifies that she is an unstained and pure virgin. The sky-colored mantle signifies that all worldly things were as dead in her heart and will. The golden tunic signifies that she was fervent and burning in the love of God, both inwardly and outwardly. Her Son, Jesus Christ, placed 7 lilies in her crown, and between the lilies he placed 7 gems. The first lily is her humility, the second lily is her fear, the third, her obedience, the fourth, her patience, the fifth, her steadfastness, the sixth, her kindness, for she is kind, and gives to all who beg of her with love, and a will to amend, the seventh, her mercy in difficulties, for in whatever difficulty a man may be in, if he calls on her with all his heart, he will receive mercy and help from her, because she is full of compassion and mercy. Between these shining lilies her Son placed 7 precious gemstones. The first gem is her incomparable virtue, for there is no virtue in any other spirit, or in any other body, which she does not have in a higher fashion. The second gem is her perfect purity, for the Queen of the Kingdom of Heaven was so pure, that from her first entrance into the world up to the final day of her death, not a single stain of sin was ever to be found in her, and none of all the devils could ever find enough impurity in her to fit on the head of a needle point. She was truly the most pure, for it was not fitting for the King of Glory to lie in any vessel but the purest, chosen before all angels and men and more pure than they. The third gem was her beauty, for God is praised constantly by his saints for his mother's beauty, and all the holy angels and holy souls are filled with joy over her beauty. The fourth precious gem in the crown is the Virgin Mother's wisdom, for she is filled with all divine wisdom in God and all wisdom is fulfilled and perfected through her. The fifth gem is her power and might, for she is so powerful and strong with God in her that she can subdue anything that has been created. The sixth gem is her clarity, for she shines so clear that she even illuminates the angels, whose eyes are clearer than light, and the devils do not dare to look upon her clarity. The seventh gem is the fullness of every delight and joy and all spiritual sweetness, for her fullness is such that there is no joy that she does not increase, no delight that is not made fuller and more perfect by her, and through the blessed vision of her, for she is filled with grace and mercy above all the holy saints. She is the most pure vessel in which the bread of angels laid, and in which all sweetness and all beauty is found. Between the 7 lilies in her crown, her Son placed these 7 gemstones. Therefore may you, her Son's bride, honor and praise her with all your heart, for she is in truth worthy of all praise and all honor with her Son. About how, on God's exhortation, the Bride of Christ chose poverty for herself, and renounced riches and carnal behavior, and about the truth of the things revealed to her, and about 3 remarkable things that Christ showed her. Chapter 32. Our Lord said to his bride, "You should be like a person who leaves, and like one who gathers. For you should leave riches and gather virtues, leave perishable things and gather eternal things, leave visible things and gather invisible. I shall namely give you the exaltation of the soul instead of the pleasures of the flesh, the joy of heaven instead of the joy of the world, the honor of the angels instead of the honor of the world, the sight of God instead of the sight of your friends. I, the giver and creator of all good things, will give you myself, instead of the possession of worldly goods. Answer me on the three things I'm going to ask you. First, do you want to be rich or poor in this world? She answered, Oh my Lord, I would rather be poor, since riches do me no good. Instead they bother, and distract me very much, and draw me away from serving you. Tell me, second, do you find anything reprehensible or false according to your conscience and heart in the words that you heard from my mouth? She answered, Certainly not, all your words are reasonable. Our Lord said for the third time, What delights you more, the sensual lust of the flesh you earlier had, or the spiritual consolation and delight that you now have? She answered, I feel ashamed and disgraced in my heart to think of my earlier fleshly lust, and it is now to me like poison and tastes all the more bitter in proportion to my earlier ardent love for it. I would rather die than ever return to such a lust. It cannot be compared to this spiritual delight and happiness. Thus, our Lord said, you confess in your mind that all the things I have told you are true. Why then are you afraid and worried that I'm delaying the things I told you would happen? Behold the prophets, and remember the apostles and the holy teachers of the church. Did they find anything in me except the truth? That is why they did not care about the world or the desire for it. Why else did the prophets foretell the future things so far in advance, unless it was because God wanted them first to proclaim the words with the deeds coming after, so that the ignorant should be taught in the faith? In truth, all the mysteries of my holy incarnation were proclaimed to the prophets before I assumed manhood and became man, even the star that went before the three kings. They believed the words of the prophet, and deserved to see what they believed in, and they were made certain immediately after they saw the star. In the same way now, my word should first be announced so that, when the deeds come later, they will be believed more surely. I showed you three things. First, the conscience of a man whose sin I revealed and proved to you by the most clear and evident signs. But why did I do so? Could I not have killed him myself? Or could I not have drowned him in a moment, if I wanted? Of course I could have. But, so that others may be instructed, and my words revealed showing how just and patient I am, and how unhappy this man is whom the devil rules, I endure him still. Because of his evil will of remaining in sin, and through his sinful lust in it, the devil's power over him has increased so much, that neither gentle words nor harsh threats nor the fear of hell can make him turn back from his sin. And this is true justice too, because, since he always had the will of sinning, even though he did not fulfill his sin by deed, he rightly deserves to be handed over to the devil for all eternity. For the smallest sin, lusted after, is enough to damn anyone from the kingdom of heaven, who does not repent. I showed you to others. The devil tormented the body of one, but was not in his soul. He darkened the other's conscience through his intrigues, and yet did not get into his soul, and had no power over him. But now you might ask, is not the soul the same as the conscience? Is the devil not in the soul, when he is in the conscience? By no means. The body has two eyes to see with, and even if they lose their sight, the body can still be healthy. So it is with the soul. For even though the reason and conscience are sometimes distracted and troubled, nevertheless, the soul does not always get hurt by the sin. And thus, the devil had power over his conscience, but not over his soul. I shall show you a third man whose soul and body are completely ruled by the devil, and unless he is forced by my power, and by my special grace, he will never be expelled from the man or leave him. From some people, the devil goes out willingly and quickly, but out of others, only reluctantly and by force. For in some people the devil enters, because of the sin of their parents, or because of some hidden judgment of God. This happens, for example, with children and witless men. He enters into others because of their infidelity, or for the sake of some other sin. From these, the devil goes out willingly. If he is exorcised by people who know conjurations or the art on how to exorcise devils, if they undertake such an exorcism for the sake of vainglory, or for some worldly gain, then the devil has the power of entering into the one exorcising him, or again, into the same person he got exorcised from, for neither of them had any love of God. From those whose soul and body the devil possesses completely, he never goes out, unless he is forced through my power. Just as vinegar, if mixed with a sweet and good wine, spoils all the sweetness of the wine, and can never be separated from it, so too will the devil not go out of the soul whom he possesses, unless he is forced through my divine power. What is this wine, if not the human soul, that was sweeter to me above all created beings, and so dear to me, that I let my sinews be slashed, and my body lacerated to the ribs for her sake? I suffered death for her sake, rather than lose her. This wine was conserved in dregs, for I placed the soul in a body, where it was kept according to my will as in a sealed vessel. But now this sweet wine has been mixed with the worst vinegar, that is, with the malice of the devil, whose evilness is more bitter and abominable to me than any vinegar. By my power, this vinegar shall be separated from this man whose name I will tell you, so that I may show my mercy and wisdom through him, but my judgment and justice through the former man. Explanation. The first man was a high-born and proud cantor who, without the Pope's permission, went to Jerusalem and was attacked by the devil. About this demon possessed man more can be read in Book 3, Chapter 31 and in Book 4, Chapter 115. The second demon-possessed man in the same chapter became a Cistercian monk. The devil tormented him so much that four men could barely hold him down. His outstretched tongue looked like an ox tongue. The shackles on his hands were invisibly broken in pieces. After a month and 2 days, this man was cured by Saint Bridget. The third demon-possessed man was a bailiff of a Sturgot land. When he was admonished to do penance, he said to the one advising him, "Cannot the owner of the house sit where he likes? The devil has my heart and my tongue, how can I do penance?" He also cursed the saints of God, and died the same night without the sacraments and confession. Our Lord's words of admonishment to the bride about true and false wisdom, and about how good angels aid the wise who are good, while devils aid the wise who are evil. Chapter 33. My friends are like scholars who have three things. First, a reasonable understanding above what is natural to the brain. Second, wisdom without human aid, for I myself teach them inwardly. Third, they are full of the sweetness and divine love with which they defeat the devil. But nowadays people study in a different way. First, they want to be wise out of vainglory, in order to be called good clerks and masterly scholars. Second, they want to be wise, in order to earn and win riches. Third, they want to be wise, in order to win honors and privileges. That is why I leave them, when they go to their schools and enter there, since they study because of pride, but I taught them humility. They enter the schools for the sake of greed, but I had no place to rest my head. They enter in order to win privileges, envying those more highly placed than themselves, but I was judged by Pilate, and mocked by Herod. That is why I will leave them, because they are not learning my wisdom. But, since I'm good and kind, I give each one what he prays for. The one who prays for bread will receive bread, and the one who prays for straw will be given straw. My friends pray for bread, because they seek and learn the wisdom of God, where my love is. But others, however, pray for straw, that is, worldly wisdom. For just as straw is useless for man to eat, but is instead the food of irrational animals, So too there is neither use for the worldly wisdom that they seek nor nourishment for the soul, but only a small name and useless work. For when a man dies, all his wisdom is eradicated into nothing, and he can no longer be seen by those who used to praise him. I'm like a mighty lord with many servants who, on their lord's way, give to the people what they need. In this way the good angels and the evil angels stand in my service. The good angels minister to those who study my wisdom, that is, those who work in my service, nourishing them with consolation and pleasing work. But the worldly wise are assisted by evil angels who inspire them with what they want, and form them after their will, inspiring them with thoughts of great speculation with much work. But if they would look to me, I could give them bread and wisdom without any work or trouble and a sufficient amount of the world to satisfy them. But they can never be filled of the world, since they turn that which is sweet into bitterness for themselves. But you, my bride, should be like cheese, and your body like the mold wherein the cheese is formed, until it has received the form of the mold. In this way, your soul, which is as delightful and sweet to me as cheese, must be tried and cleansed in the body, until body and soul united, agree to maintain the same form of abstinence, so that the flesh obeys the spirit and the spirit leads the flesh toward all virtues. The teaching of Christ to his bride about how she should live, and also about how the devil admits to Christ that the bride loves Christ above all things, and about how the devil asks Christ why he loves her so much, and about the love that Christ has for the bride. Chapter 34. I'm the creator of the heavens and the earth. I was true God and true man in the virgin's womb, and I rose from the dead, and ascended into heaven. You, my new bride, have come to an unknown place. Therefore, you must do four things. First, you must know the language of the place. Second, you must have proper clothes. Third, you must know how to organize your days and your time according to the custom of the place. Fourth, you must become accustomed to the new food. So, since you have come from the instability of the world to stability, you must learn a new language, that is, the abstinence from useless and vain words and sometimes even from permissible ones, in order to observe the importance and virtue of silence. Second, your clothes should be humble both in the interior and exterior, so that you do not extol yourself inwardly as being holier than others, nor are outwardly ashamed to be seen as humble before people. Third, your time should be ordered in such a way that, just as you before used to have much time for the needs of the body, so now you should only have time for the soul, that is, to never again want to sin against me. Fourth, your new food is abstinence from gluttony, and from delicacies with all prudence, as far as your human nature can endure it. The abstinence that goes beyond the capacity of human nature is not pleasing to me, for I demand the rational and the taming of lusts. Then the devil appeared in the same moment. Our Lord said to him, "You were created by me, and have seen all justice in me. Answer me now, whether this new bride of mine is lawfully mine by proven justice. For I allow you to see and understand her heart, so that you may know how to answer me. Does she love anything else as much as me, or would she take anything in exchange for me?" The devil answered, "She loves nothing as much as you, and rather than losing you, she would suffer any torment, if only you gave her the virtue of patience. I see like a bond of fire descending from you to her, and it ties her heart so much, that she thinks of, and loves nothing but you." Then our Lord said to the devil, "Tell me how she pleases your heart, or how you like this great love I have for her." The devil said, "I have two eyes, one is corporeal, although I'm not corporeal, and with this eye I perceive temporal things, so clearly that there is nothing, so secret or dark, that it could hide itself from me. The second eye is spiritual, and I see, so clearly with it, that there is no pain so small, that I cannot see and understand to which sin it belongs. And there is no sin so small or slight, that I do not see it, unless it has been purged by repentance and penance. But, although there are no body parts more sensitive and vulnerable than the eyes, I would still much rather desire that two burning torches without end penetrated my eyes than for her to see with the eyes of the spirit. I also have two heirs. One is corporeal, and no one can speak so secretly and silently that I do not immediately hear and know it through this ear. The second ear is spiritual, and no one can have such a secret thought or desire for any sin that I do not hear it through this ear, unless it has been washed away by penance. And I would gladly prefer that the suffering of hell, surging forward like a stream, and spreading the most terrible hot fire without end, flowed through my ears than that she should hear anything with the ears of the spirit. I also have a spiritual heart, and I would gladly let it be ceaselessly cut to pieces and constantly renewed to the same suffering in order for her heart to grow cold in your service and love. But, since you are righteous, I now have a question for you, that you may answer. Tell me, why do you love her so much? Why did you not choose someone holier, richer, and prettier for yourself? Our Lord answered, because justice demanded this. You were created by me, and have seen all justice in me. Tell me, while she is listening, why it was justice that you should have such a bad fall and what you were thinking when you fell. The devil answered, I saw three things in you. I saw your glory and honor being above all things, and I thought about my own glory. For this reason I became proud, and decided to not merely become your equal, but to be even higher than you. Second, I saw that you were mightier than all others, and therefore I desired to be more mighty than you. Third, I saw what would happen in the future, and since your glory and honor are without beginning, and would be without end, I envied you, and thought that I would gladly be tortured forever by the most bitter punishment if, thereby, you would die. And with such thoughts and desires I fell, and immediately hell was created. Our Lord answered, you ask me, why I love my bride so much. Assuredly, it is because I change all your malice into good. For since you became proud, and did not want to have me, your creator, as your equal, therefore, humiliating myself in all things, I gather sinners to myself, and make myself their equal, by giving them my glory. Second, since you had such an evil desire, that you wanted to be more mighty than I, therefore I make sinners more mighty than you, and partakers in my power. Third, because of your envy against me, I'm so full of love, that I offered myself up, and sacrificed myself for the sake of everyone through my death. Thereafter, our Lord said, now, devil, your dark heart is enlightened. Tell me, while she is listening, what love I have for her. The devil answered, if it were possible, you would gladly suffer the same pain in each and every limb, just as you once suffered on the cross in all your limbs, before losing her. Then our Lord answered, since I'm so merciful, that I do not refuse my mercy and forgiveness to anyone asking for it, ask me then humbly for mercy yourself, and I will give it to you. The devil answered, never shall I do this. For when I fell, a punishment was established for every sin, and for every worthless word and thought. And every spirit or devil that fell, will have his punishment. And before I would bend my knee before you, I would rather swallow all the punishments in me, as long as my mouth could be opened and closed in punishment, so that my punishment would be forever renewed. Then our Lord said to his bride, see how hardened the Lord of the world is, and how mighty he is against me, because of my hidden justice. I could indeed destroy him in a moment through my power, but I do no more injustice to him than to a good angel in the kingdom of heaven. But when his time comes, and it is now approaching, I shall judge him with his followers. Therefore, my bride, may you always persevere in good deeds. Love me with all your heart. Fear nothing but me. I'm namely the Lord over the devil, and over all things created. The Virgin Mary's words to the bride about her own sorrow at the suffering of Christ, and about how the world was sold through Adam and Eve, and bought back as with one heart through Christ and his Virgin Mother. Chapter 35. Mary, the Mother of God, spoke to the bride of Christ and said, "My daughter, consider the suffering of my son, for his limbs were like my own limbs and his heart like my own heart. For just as other children used to be carried in the womb of their mother, so was he in me. But he was conceived through the burning charity of God's love. Others, however, are conceived through the lust of the flesh." Thus, John the Evangelist, his cousin, rightly says, "The Word was made flesh. He came through love, and was in me. The Word and love created him in me. He was truly for me like my own heart. For when I gave birth to him, I felt as though half my heart was born, and went out of me. And when he endured suffering, it felt like my own heart was suffering. Just as when something is half inside and half outside, the half outside feels pain and suffering, but the inside also feels a similar pain, so it was for me, when my son was scourged and wounded, it was as if my own heart was scourged and wounded. I was also the one closest to him at his suffering, and I was never separated from him. I stood very near his cross, and just like that which is closest to the heart stings the worst, so his pain was heavier and worse for me than for others. When he looked at me from the cross and I saw him, then tears flowed from my eyes like blood from veins. And when he saw me so stricken with pain and overwhelming sorrow, he felt such a sorrow over my pain that all the pain of his own wounds became as subsided, and ed for the sake of the pain he saw in me. I can therefore boldly say, that his pain was my pain, since his heart was my heart. For just as Adam and Eve sold the world for an apple, so my son, and I bought back the world as with one heart. Consider therefore, my daughter, how I was at the death of my son, and it will not be hard for you to give up the world and her cares." Our Lord's answer to an angel, who was praying, that sorrow in body and soul should be given to the bride, and about how even greater sorrow should be given to more perfect souls. Chapter 36. An angel was praying for his Lord's bride and our Lord answered him, "You are like a knight of the Lord, who never took off his helmet for the sake of sloth, and who never turned his eyes away from the battle for the sake of fear. You are steadfast as a mountain, and burning like a flame. You are so pure, that there is no stain in you. You beg me to have mercy on my bride. You know and see all things in me. Nevertheless, while she is listening, tell me what kind of mercy you are asking for her, for mercy is namely threefold. One is the mercy by which the body is punished and tortured, and the soul is spared, as it happened with my servant Job, whose flesh had to suffer all kinds of pain and torment, but whose soul was protected. The second mercy is the one by which soul and body are spared from torment, as it was in the case of the king who lived in all sorts of lust and worldly pleasure, and had no pain either in body or soul, while he lived in the world. The third mercy is the one by which soul and body are punished, so that they have distress in their flesh and sorrow in their heart, as it happened with Peter and Paul and other saints. For there are three states for humans in the world. The first state is that of those who fall into sin, and get up again. These do I sometimes allow to suffer in their bodies, so that they may be saved. The second state is that of those who would gladly live forever, to be able to sin forever, and who have all of their will and thought directed to the world, and if they do anything for me at any time, they do it with the intention of their worldly possessions growing and prospering. Neither punishment of the body nor very much pain of the heart is given to these people, but instead they are allowed to follow their own power and will, because they will receive a reward here for the least little good they have done for me, to then be tormented for all eternity. For since their will to sin is everlasting, their torment shall also be everlasting. The third state is that of those who are more afraid of sinning against me and offending me than they fear any torment. They would rather endure to be tortured with unbearable pain in eternity than consciously provoke me to wrath. Sorrow of body and heart are given to these men, as with Peter and Paul and other saints, so that they may amend for all their sins in this world, or so that they may be chastised for a time for the sake of their greater glory, and as an example to others. I have shown this threefold mercy to three persons in this kingdom, whose names are well known to you. But now, my angel and servant, tell me, for what kind of mercy do you pray for my bride? He answered, I pray for the mercy of her soul and body, so that she may amend for all her sins in this world, and so that none of her sins may come before your judgment. Our Lord answered, May it be done according to your will. Then he said to the bride, You are mine and I will do with you as I please. Love nothing as much as me. Purify yourself constantly from sin every hour according to the advice of those I have entrusted you to. Hide no sin. Leave nothing unexamined. Do not consider any sin to be light or worthy of disregard. For anything you forget, I will remind you of and judge. None of the sins you have done will come before my judgment, if they are punished and expiated through your penance while you live. But those sins for which you made no penance will be purged either in purgatory, or by some secret judgment of mine, unless you make a full satisfaction and amendment for them here in the world. The words of the Virgin Mother to the bride about the excellence of her Son, and about how Christ is now being crucified more cruelly by his enemies, the evil Christians, than he once was by the Jews, and about how such people will receive a harder and more bitter punishment. Chapter 37. The Queen of Heaven said, My son had three good things. The first one was that no one ever had such a beautiful body as he did, since he had two perfect natures, namely, his divinity and manhood. His body was so pure that, just as no stain can be found in the clearest of eyes, so not a single defect could be found on his body. The second good was, that he never sinned. Other children, however, sometimes bear the sins of their parents and sometimes their own, but he never sinned, and yet bore the sins of everyone. The third good was, that some men die for the sake of God and to receive a greater reward, but he died, just as much for the sake of his enemies as for me and his friends. When his enemies crucified him, they did four things to him. First, they crowned him with a crown of thorns. Second, they pierced his hands and feet. Third, they gave him gall to drink. Fourth, they pierced his side. But now I complain that the enemies of my son, who are now in the world, crucify him more cruelly in a spiritual sense than the Jews who crucified his body. For even though the divinity is unable to suffer and die, still they crucify him through their own vices and sins. For if a man insults and injures an image of his enemy, the image does not feel the damage done to it. Nevertheless, the perpetrator should be accused and judged for his evil intention to do harm, as though it was a deed. In the same way, the vices and sins by which they crucify my son spiritually are more abominable and heavy to him than the vices of those who crucified his body. But now you may ask, how do they crucify him? First off, they fasten him on the cross they have prepared for him, when they do not heed the commandments of their Creator and Lord, but dishonor him, when he warns them through his servants to serve him, and they despise this, and instead do what pleases them. Then they crucify his right hand, when they hold justice to be as injustice, saying, Sin is not so heavy and abominable to God as it is said. God does not punish anyone for all eternity, he only threatens us with these hard things to scare us. Why else would he redeem man, if he wanted us to perish? They do not consider that the least little sin a man finds delight in is enough to damn him to an eternal torment, and that God does not let the least little sin go unpunished, just like he does not let the least little good deed go unrewarded. Therefore, they shall be tormented for all eternity, because of their constant intention of sinning, and my son, who sees the heart, counts that as a deed. for they would fulfill their will with deeds, if my son tolerated or allowed it. Then they crucify his left hand, when they turn virtue into sin and the will, to continue in sin until the end, saying, if we just once say at the end of our life, O God, have mercy on me, God's mercy is so great, that we will be forgiven. But this is not virtue, to want to sin without bettering oneself, and wanting to receive reward without having to work for it, not unless a real contrition is found in the heart, that the man wants to change, if only he could do so were it, not for illness or some other hindrance. Thereafter, they crucify his feet, when they take pleasure, in sinning without once thinking of my son's bitter suffering, or without once thanking him from their inmost heart with words like these, my Lord and God, how bitter your suffering was, praise and honor be to you for your death, such words are never heard from their mouth. They then crown him with the crown of derision, when they mock his servants, and consider it useless to serve him. They give him gall, to drink when they rejoice, and glory in sin. And not once does the thought arise in their heart of how grave and manifold and dangerous this sin is. They pierce his side, when they have the will to continue in sin. In truth, I tell you, and you can say this to my friends, that such people are more unjust in the sight of my son than those who judged him, more unkind than those who crucified him, more shameless than those who sold him, and they shall therefore receive a greater torment than the others. Pilate knew very well, that my son had not sinned, and did not deserve to die. But he, nonetheless, felt compelled to judge my son to death, because he feared the loss of his worldly power and the revolt of the Jews. But what would these have to fear, if they served my son, or what honor or dignity would they lose, if they honored him? They will therefore be judged with a more severe sentence than Pilate's, for they are worse than him in my son's sight. For Pilate judged him, because of the request, and will of others, and due to fear, but these judge him for their own advantage, and without any fear, when they dishonor him by committing the sin, that they could abstain from if they wanted. But they do not abstain from sin, nor are they ashamed of the sins that they have done, for they do not consider that they are unworthy of the good deeds of the one whom they do not serve. They are also worse than Judas, for when Judas had betrayed his Lord, he knew very well that he was God, and that he had sinned heavily against him, but he despaired and hastened his days toward hell, thinking himself to be unworthy to live. But these know their sin very well, and yet they continue in it without feeling any remorse about it in their hearts. They want to take the kingdom of heaven with violence and power, when they think they can get it, not through their good deeds, but through a vain hope, but it is only given to those who work, and suffer something for the sake of God. They are also worse than those who crucified my son. For when these saw the good works of my son, namely, the raising of the dead and the cleansing of lepers, they thought to themselves, this man does unheard of and extraordinary miracles. He overcomes anyone he wants with a word, he knows all our thoughts, and he does whatever he wants. If he is successful, we will all have to submit to his power, and become his subjects. Therefore, in order to avoid being subjected to him, they crucified him, because of their envy. But if they had known that he was the King of Glory, they never would have crucified him. But these people see his great deeds and miracles every day, and they take advantage of his good deeds, and hear how they should serve him, and come to him, but they think to themselves, if we must leave all our temporal belongings, and follow his will, and not our own, it would be heavy and unbearable. They despise his will, so that it should not be placed over their own will, and crucify my son through their hardened heart, when they add sin upon sin against their conscience. They are worse than those who crucified my son, for the Jews did it for the sake of envy, and because they did not know that he was God, but these know him to be God, and yet, in their own malice and presumption and greed, they crucify him spiritually more cruelly than the Jews did physically. For they themselves have been redeemed, but the Jews had not yet been redeemed. Therefore, My bride, obey my son and fear him, for just as he is merciful, he is also just. The most pleasant conversation of God the Father with the Son, and about how the Father gave the new bride to the Son, and how the Son received her with pleasure to himself, and about how the bridegroom teaches the bride about patience, obedience, and simplicity through an example. Chapter 38. The Father spoke to the Son, saying, I came with love to the virgin, and took your true body from her. You are therefore in me, and I in you. Just as fire and heat are never separated, so it is impossible to separate the divinity from the manhood. The Son answered, May all glory and honor be to your Father, may your will be done in me and mine in you. The Father answered him again, Behold, my Son, I'm entrusting this new bride to you like a sheep to be guided and educated. As the owner of the sheep, you will get from her cheese to eat, and milk to drink, and wool to clothe yourself with. But you, bride, should obey him. You have three things you must do. You have to be patient, obedient and willing to do what is good. Then the Son said to the Father, Your will with power, power with humility, humility with wisdom, wisdom with mercy, may your will be done, which is and always will be without beginning or end in me. I take her to myself into my love, into your power, and into the guidance of the Holy Spirit, which are not three gods but one God. Then the Son said to his bride, You have heard how the Father entrusted you to me like a sheep. You must therefore be simple-minded and patient like a sheep and fruitful, in producing food and clothing. Three people are in the world. The first is completely naked, the second is thirsty, and the third is hungry. The first signifies the faith of my church, and it is naked, because everyone is ashamed and afraid to speak of the true faith, and of my commandments. And if some people do speak or teach about such things, they are despised and accused of being liars. Therefore, my words which proceed from my mouth, should clothe this faith like wool. For just as wool grows on the body of a sheep by the heat, so too my words proceed from the heat of my divinity and manhood to your heart. They will clothe my holy faith with the testimony of truth and wisdom, and prove that the faith which is now regarded as vain is true, so that the ones who, up to now, have been lazy in clothing their faith in deeds of love after hearing my words of love, will be converted and enkindled again, in order to speak with certitude of faith and act with power. The second one signifies my friends who have a thirsting desire, to make my honor perfect, and are saddened at my dishonor. They shall be filled with the sweetness, that they heard in my words, and enkindled with a greater love for me, and along with them, others who are now dead in sin, will also be enkindled in my love, when they hear of the mercy I have done with sinners. The third one signifies those who think thus in their hearts, If only we knew the will of God, and how we should live, and if anyone taught us about the good way, we would gladly do what we could for the honor of God. These are hungry to get to know my way and will, but no one feeds them, since no one shows them completely what they should do, and if they are shown, or taught what to do, no one lives according to the words with their deeds. And for this reason, the words seem as dead to them. Therefore, I myself shall show and teach them what they should do, and I will fill them with my sweetness. For worldly things, which are seen and desired now almost by everyone, cannot fill mankind, but only arouse his desire and greed of the world, to win more and more things. But my words and my love will feed men and fill them with an overflowing consolation. Therefore, my bride, who are my sheep, you must take great care, to keep your patience and obedience. You are all mine by right, and should therefore follow my will. The one who wants to follow the will of another should have three things. First, he should have the same will, and opinion as the other. Second, have similar deeds. Third, he should move away from his enemies. But who are my enemies, if not pride and every sin? You should therefore move away from them, if you desire to follow my will.